Next to Carol is Zachary Roth, who is a former national reporter for MSNBC and author of The Great Suppression, Voting Rights, Corporate Cash, and the Conservative Assault on Democracy. Next to Zachary is Adam Eichen. Adam Eichen is the co-author of Daring Democracy, Igniting Power, Meaning, and Connection for the America We Want. Next to Adam is Representative Greg Vitali, who I will only introduce by saying he's one of my favorite representatives in Harrisburg. So thank you all for coming out to this event. I'd like to start just by saying a little bit about March on Harrisburg and who we are. March on Harrisburg is a nonpartisan, statewide volunteer group, and we are working to heal our wounded democracy and to restore trust in our republic. We have been lobbying for three bills. Our three bills, the first one is to ban unlimited gifts to state legislators. That's SB 132, HB 39. Representative Vitali, I believe you're a co-sponsor on all our bills.
No, I actually got on the final bill we got on the voter registration today.
Our second bill is to end gerrymandering. That's SB 22 and HB 722. And our third bill is automatic voter registration. HB 193, SB 608. And to get these three bills passed, we have been lobbying since November. We have now met with about 230 out of the 253 state legislators in Harrisburg. We know with some confidence that should our bills, should gift ban and gerrymandering come to a vote, they would pass. We also have been marching. We set off from Philadelphia on Saturday, May 13th with the kickoff rally. We are about 50 miles into our march and we'll be arriving in Harrisburg on Sunday evening. And then our third phase is this Monday through Wednesday, we're going to be lobbying intensively at the state capitol and possibly doing nonviolent direct action should our bills not get out of committee and come to a vote. So March on Harrisburg, we see ourselves as the marriage counselors in society. Right now, government and governed, state and citizen, do not communicate very well. They do not see each other, they do not hear each other, and the relationship is in a very bad place. It's oftentimes indifferent, and it's too often abusive. And so we have come in as the marriage counselors to say, it's time for an intervention, we need to repair this relationship. To give a sense of what we're up to, I just have to tell a quick little parable from Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel. It tells a story of a band of inexperienced mountain climbers who are hiking along a ridge, and they fell off the ridge into a pit, and it was a deep and dark pit. And a snake came out of the rocks and came toward the mountain climbers, and one of them beat the snake back. And then three more snakes came out of the rocks, and the mountain climbers beat the snakes back again. And then five snakes, and then 10 snakes, and more kept coming out of the rocks, and the mountain climbers kept beating them back one by one. But there was one mountain climber who wasn't helping to fend off the snakes. And the other mountain climber said, "Why aren't you helping us? If you don't help us, we're gonna die. The snakes are gonna get to us." And the mountain climber said, "Well, if we just fend off the snakes, we're gonna stay down here and die. I'm searching for a way out of the pit." So right now in our society, there's a lot of chaos going on. And March on Harrisburg are trying to find our way out of the pit, out of the chaos. And we believe that the way to do that is to repair our democracy. So I'd like to open up the panel discussion with a question for Carol Kuniholm. Can you please describe gerrymandering? Can you please inform the audience in a few minutes what the situation is in Pennsylvania?
We have these maps that have to be redrawn. drawn every 10 years. And the people who draw the maps in most countries are not connected to the elections that are governed by those maps. But here in the United States, more so in some states than others, the legislators have a direct hand. And here in Pennsylvania, the legislators have complete control over how the maps are drawn. The legislature passes as a bill the maps for congressional districts, and there's a five-person committee that passes the maps for the state Senate and House bills. So they're able to play around with those maps, draw them any way they want, to make sure that the people they want elected get elected, the people they want to have disappear get drawn out of the maps, and also to manipulate the maps so that the party that does the drawing of the maps ends up with more districts than the others.
Thank you. Can you talk about when you first got involved in the fight to end gerrymandering last January, and what the journey has been like for you?
So I did not wake up one morning and say, gerrymandering, that's my deal. That did not happen. I have had a kind of an interesting career. I started out as a lit professor, took time off to stay home with my kids. By the time I went back to work, I had really changed perspective, and I ended up being a youth pastor for 11 years at the Church of the Good Samaritan in Paoli, a fairly affluent suburban church that has a partnership with a church in Kensington, Philadelphia, one of the poorer sections of Philadelphia. And part of my job was to take a group of teens and young adults from my church into Kensington every summer and spend a week doing a children's outreach with the teens in that church. So we'd spend a week together in the summer, and I love what March on Harrisburg is doing because I love that feeling of a team of folks who spend all day after day together doing something, sleep on the floor, hear each other breathe, eat food together. That's what we would do for a week every summer, and then we'd invite the teens from that church to come and stay in our homes for a week so that we could do a kids program from our church. So we got to be very good friends, spent a lot of time together, and in the course of that, one of the things that kids talk about is their schools. And so the kids would talk about schools. I had kids in my youth group who went to some of the best funded, well-funded schools on the planet. They had school trips to Europe. I would go watch their school plays. Every kid would have one of those nice fancy little microphones attached to their shirts. They were well-funded, well-run, tons of school counselors, anything you could want in a school. Those wonderful magic whiteboards that do all sorts of techie stuff, everything. The other kids went to schools that didn't have auditoriums. They didn't have school trips. They didn't have school counselors. They didn't have school nurses. The elementary school near us, they would do their graduation in the church sanctuary, the church where we did our program. As I was leaving that, there was a new school that was being built on the field where we often played soccer in the evenings. And it was replacing a school that had been the oldest school in the city, had no, as I said, no auditorium. There were kids who were physically handicapped who were told in fire drills to go stand on the fire escape, because there was no way to get them out of the building. So they were finally building a new school, and the kids from my church said, hey, let's get books for their school library. We want to do something to house, we want to offer something to this school as it's being built. And we said, that's a great idea. So I contacted the new school and said, we would like to provide books for your library. There's a long pause, and then, that won't be possible. So why would that not be possible? Because there won't be a library. Why will there not be a library? There's no funding for a library. There's no funding for a librarian. So that was just as I was leaving youth ministry. I could not get that out of my mind because I was a poor kid in a fairly wealthy community, and I lived in my school library. And I dreamed of a world by reading the books in that library, and the thought that we would have kids in the most under-resourced kids who have very little vision of a world beyond their neighborhood, not to have a school library. I couldn't get it out of my mind. So I began to try to understand how that happened. And I ended up in the League of Women Voters because they are people who like to understand how things happen. They love to do research. They love to study things. And the more I studied, the more I dug, the more I realized we have the most inequitable school funding formula in the country, twice as inequitable as the next most inequitable. Reading has the grand privilege of being the most underfunded school district in the nation. Did you know that? Allentown number two. And as I studied that, I began talking with people who were concerned about that, and what they told me was, this is not going to get fixed until we fix the way our legislature works, because the legislature, the leadership in the legislature, does not care. So that led me to be, I became a member of the State Board of the League of Women Voters. I petitioned strongly for them to create a position on election reform, and I took that position. And once I joined that position, I began looking at the way our elections work, and it became incredibly clear to me that we have leadership in our legislature that controls everything. And the way they manage to do that is through gerrymandering. They're the ones who draw the maps, they're the ones who decide whose bills get to move forward, whose bills don't. And the more I've talked to legislators, the more clear it is to me. Until we fix that, there's really very, very little that will be fixed. So that's how I got started on this. And what keeps me going, and day by day, the job has grown and grown and grown and grown, and some days I think if it grows anymore, I will not be allowed to sleep any longer, which would be a problem. The thing that motivates me is to think of those kids who are in many ways like my family, and to think, I can't sleep at night knowing that they don't have a school library, that they don't have school counselors. I have a young friend who has two children. Her kids, she herself never went to ninth grade. She is just barely literate. She cannot do her multiplication tables. Her kids started school very far behind, and they were put in kindergarten classes with 30 kids. The kids in my community do not have 30 kids in the class, and they have multiple aides. Those kids are in a class with 30 with no aides, and every one of those kids starts school behind, and by the time they're in second grade, they are so far behind they'll never catch up. I can't live with that knowledge without doing something, so this is the something I'm doing.
Well, thank you for doing this. So one of Marshall Harrisburg's bills is to end gerrymandering, and another one of our bills is to enact a system for automatic voter registration. So Zach, you are an expert on voting laws in the United States of America, and I would like to ask you to first kind of articulate why voting is important, what is the function of it in our society, and why is this a passion of yours?
Thanks. Why voting is important? It's an interesting question, actually, because one of the things I wrote about in my book is I think most of us, and by that I mean sort of progressives in general, but I also think probably most Americans who haven't really thought about it much and don't necessarily identify themselves anywhere on the political spectrum, think of voting as something that everybody should do and that we should encourage everybody to vote. That's the kind of default assumption we have about voting. And the reason for that, when we think about it, is because voting is a way to represent everybody's interests equally. So, and so the more people whose interests are represented in a given election, the more legitimate we feel the result is. It's a way of dividing power among political equals. And underlying that is the assumption that we are all political equals and we all get one vote. What I wrote about in the book is that though most of us think that, that there are many people who actually don't think about voting that way and are quite open about it and think about voting instead, and this is a reasonable thing to think in some ways, I don't mean to diminish it. They think about voting as a means to an end. If we all vote and we all kind of use our best judgment, we'll likely get the best result, and so we'll elect the wisest leader. So it's less about dividing power among equals, more about the end result of electing good government. And as I said, there's something to that. But what that then means often is they don't see us as all political equals deserving of everybody having an equal say. It leads to a view that people who are more informed or more engaged or speak English or have more time to study issues should actually have a larger say in our politics than people who don't. And so it might make sense to enact restrictions on voting that don't bar anybody from voting, but that can make it difficult for some people to vote. And if that keeps out people who are not paying as much attention or not as engaged, maybe that's for the best. And I'm not making up that idea. That's a point of view that you actually hear quite commonly expressed even by mainstream people in the conservative movement. I'm thinking about George Will, who's a very prominent columnist for the Washington Post, who writes, you know, having the need to register to vote is a small burden on voting that makes sense because it filters out people who are less motivated and therefore less likely to sort of to increase the caliber of the electorate, as he puts it. So that's, anyway, a sort of ideological way of thinking about voting. And I think it's important to understand at this moment, because it's one of the things that lies behind the wave of voting restrictions that we've seen over the last decade. Don't get me wrong, 90% of that, the motivation for that is partisanship. If you can make it, and let's be clear who we're talking about, if Republicans can make it more difficult for people who tend to vote Democratic to vote, that is racial minorities, the poor, and the young, then they're going to have an easier time in the elections. And that's most of what's driving this. But I do think it's important to understand that ideological component too. I don't even remember what the question was.
I'll just jump in here for a moment and say that in a lot of our meetings in Harrisburg, we have gotten that ideological answer. We've gotten that answer from a lot of people. And it's not, in Harrisburg, it's fascinating how complex people's motivations are. And we've actually gotten Republicans who are supporting this bill for some strange reasons. They have large immigrant populations in their district who they would like to see registered to vote because they have good relationships with them. We've had Democrats who have been against this bill. One person in particular, Representative Nielsen, told us, I don't have enough money to reach out to more people when campaigning, so therefore they shouldn't. It is laughable, right?
I think it's very scary for a lot of elected officials, Democratic and Republican, to think about expanding the electorate, because they've gotten elected with a certain electorate. And if now there's this larger pool that they have to worry about, as Michael says, that's a new challenge for them. You want me to talk a bit about like voter registration? Because I think that's really key. At the same time that there has been this wave of restrictions on voting in many states, and we're talking a little bit about Pennsylvania there, which, as you guys I'm sure know, passed the voter ID law in 2012, I think, which was then struck down by the courts in 2013. Other states have passed voter ID laws that have not been struck down and remain on the books. They've passed cuts to early voting, they've restricted the way you can register. There's been a whole sequence of laws passed by states that have made it more difficult to vote, from Arizona to Texas to North Carolina to Wisconsin to you name it almost. And they've been aided by a Supreme Court decision that happened in 2013 that weakened a key part of the Voting Rights Act, where most southern states had to get approval from the federal government before enacting new voting restrictions to make sure that they didn't harm racial minorities. That part of the Voting Rights Act was sort of invalidated by the Supreme Court, and that's what has allowed many of these laws to go ahead. Anyway, at the same time that this has happened, there is a more hopeful side to this. There is a movement for expansive voting laws that expand access to the ballot. And one of the key policies that's part of this is what's called automatic voter registration, which has been passed.
SB 608 HB 1393.
Okay, so that's the Pennsylvania bill. It's been passed in just in the last 2 years by six states, or enacted by six states, including California, the biggest state in the country. So there's an enormous amount of momentum behind it amongst voting rights advocates and good government advocates. And what it does is it automatically registers you to vote when you come in contact with the DMV or sometimes with other government agencies. So when you do business with the DMV, unless you affirmatively choose to opt out, you don't have to register. So unless you affirmatively choose to opt out, it will register you to vote. And all that's doing is switching the default from unregistered to registered. You can still choose to opt out, but most people don't. Most people want to be registered. And already in Oregon, which is the first Berks to enact it, and it went into effect last year. It's had an enormous effect on increasing the voter rolls, and not only in sheer numbers, but in terms of the kinds of people who are registering to vote. Now, marginalized communities, who previously nobody was asking them to register, they did not have the same access to voting that many of us do. And so it's really a potentially transformative policy, and it would be great to see more and more states enact it.
Thank you. Automatic voter registration made it into Marshall Harrisburg's legislative agenda because voting is one of the key points of communication between citizen and state. And so to open up that line of communication, automatic voter registration encourages that. Representative Vitali, I would like to ask you a question. Automatic voter registration would probably mean that your legs would become much stronger because you are a door knocker. You are somebody who walks around your district and gets to know constituents. So you would, actually, you already do get to know everybody. So I would actually like to ask you about the natural gas industry in Harrisburg and in Pennsylvania, because you are a bit of an expert on this. You have butted heads with them several times. And I would like to ask first, just what are their practices in Harrisburg? What are they up to?
You know, I've been a state rep for 25 years, and I've been on the environmental committee working on environmental policy up until this past January 5th, which was when they took me off as chairman because I spoke out against some very non-transparent things they were doing with the House rules, which is one of the prices you pay when you disagree publicly with power. But I've been working on mainly things like climate change, renewable energy, energy conservation on one side, and also Marcellus drilling and trying to make it safer and imposing as stringent regulations you can upon the drilling industry, as well as making them pay their fair share in terms of severance tax. And over the years, I've just been increasingly frustrated with the legislature and our inability to get good legislation passed. For example, the severance tax was introduced in the Dell administration. You just see it term after term being introduced, something that would provide vital needed money for the Commonwealth. We have like a $3 billion deficit, and every other natural gas producing state has one, but we don't have one, and it's thwarted year after year. I've seen conventional drilling regulations, just basic safety regulations like standards for cleanups and timeframes that spills have to be cleaned up. And it's just good practices of if you degrade a water supply, you have to restore it to safe drinking waters, and just basic stuff. I've watched this, you know, move through the legislative process for 5 years, and then budget after budget just be thwarted, just in the end, struck down. And you sort of understand why by just sort of being there. I mean, you can't go to an environmental committee without seeing the lobbyists, just phalanx of well-heeled, well-dressed lobbyists just crowding the place. Or you can't walk through any congestion point in the Capitol and see the faces of these lobbyists. And you just know, that it's the influence of money, of campaign contributions and lobbying on the process that really just kills good environmental legislation, promotes bad environmental legislation. So what I started to do in the fall is really try to quantify it. So what we did, we really built on what Common Cause of Pennsylvania had been doing, and PA Conservation Voters. I'm friends with Barry Kaufman and Josh McNeil, and we really built on work they had. And we just tried to quantify the influence Marcellus money on the legislative process. So we looked at all the campaign expense reports, of the lobbying reports of the drilling company, which really came up with some startling conclusions. One of which was, we were talking a little earlier, the drilling industry, there's 203 lobbyists working for the drilling industry. committee. That's coincidentally one for each state house member. We all kind of have our personal lobbies. Not really. Michael Pollack probably has 29-0. We're also, again, building on the great work of Common Cause. You know, over $60 million in lobbying expenses was, you know, spent by the drillers lobbying the Pennsylvania legislature over the past 10 years. $60 million, that's just staggering. And as far as campaign contributions, we just identified we identified who's getting the money. The top money getter last year was Speaker Terzai, who got $78,000, Senator Scarnati over $50,000. I mean, just certain companies like Consul, and there's a story about Consul, what they're doing right now to kind of mess up one of our state parks in Greene County, and I just pulled it, you know, a little bit of an aside, you know. End of March, Consul gave Senator Scarnati a $5,000 contribution. 2 weeks later, he introduces a bill that undermines the ability of the Environmental Quality Board to undermines what they did in trying to protect streams in that park. So we looked at campaign contributions, we looked at lobbying expenses, we saw these relationships, and we developed our own slideshow presentation, which we're walking around. We're just trying to sort of expose that influence. And the idea is if you expose it, then you can just maybe sort of lessen it a bit. And then we talk in the report about things that need to be done, like, you know, campaign finance, contribution limits, which the state does not have, you know, a better search function for our campaign, State Department website, total gift ban by legislators, you know, things like or first bank disclosure, things like that, better reporting requirements. So that's sort of what I've been working on the past couple of months.
Thank you. Representative, I'd like to ask you a follow-up question. We've learned in Harrisburg that sometimes what's more effective than campaign contributions are lobbying expenses, because lobbyists can kind of get very close with politicians and become their friends. And you can give unlimited gifts, and I would just like for you to kind of describe what that looks like in practice.
Yeah, I mean, you're right. That is the strategy of lobbyists. And then what you see, you go to any you know, restaurant in Harrisburg area on a session Monday or a Tuesday, and you'll see a group of legislators and a lobbyist and his credit card. And you're wined and you're dined. I'm not, but you're wined and you're dined, or they take you to ball games, or you have your cigar caucus, and there's gifts and all that. And the whole philosophy is sort of just to become your friend. That's the strategy of the lobbyist. It's just you want to become your friend because, you know, friends help friends. And you're like, can you help me out on this amendment? And, yeah. So that is the strategy that lobbyists use. And that's why you have to sort of expose this nexus between, you know, a good lobbying bill needs to reveal what lobbyist is giving what gift to what legislator for what bill. And our current lobbying does not do that, because unless a constituent can see concurrent with the vote a legislator takes, the contributions he's receiving, the gifts he's receiving, you're not going to shape conduct. Legislators need to be stung and questioned by their constituents. Now, you voted against the severance tax. I know, I heard what you said, but you also took $5,000 from this company who would have had to have paid it. I mean, what's going on with that? And I think if you can expose this nexus, you're more likely to kind of, I mean, but the trick is, I mean, the trick in all of this, and the challenge in all of this, is that the people who are in a position to change these rules are the ones who are winning by them. I mean, that's the challenge. The only time I've seen real meaningful change, that was only for a while, was back in 2005 when we had that pay raise, middle of the night pay raise, and the public was just furious. And legislators lost their jobs. Leaders were defeated in elections. So unless your lobby can take this to a point where you can put the fear of these people in losing their jobs, or the members of losing their jobs, it's going